So I'm just boiling some water here. I want to talk about latent heat and heat transfer around the globe in the weather and climate system. Water vapor, a gas, is forming on the hot glass beneath the liquid water. But the steam we see is tiny little water droplets, so it's changed back into the liquid form, and that's being carried up by the buoyant water vapor, because as it's hot, it rises. Clouds are made when rising water vapor cools and it forms tiny little liquid water droplets, which is essentially the same as what steam is, tiny liquid droplets suspended in the air and surrounded by invisible water vapor, which is what those bubbles are made of.
When the water in the pot reaches 100 Celsius, it doesn't suddenly disappear. It takes energy to convert it from liquid to gas. You get that energy, it's called latent heat, back when it condenses into liquid again. So looking at the skew T chart, these green numbers here are how much water the atmosphere can hold at different temperatures, and you can see it exponentially increases. So it's really cold at Macquarie Island, but there's still, you know, a fair bit of cloud around. And we can see there's 7.8 mils of precipitable water in the atmosphere, whereas if we go to all the way up from Macquarie Island right up to Willis Island, we can see there's some clouds around still, but it's pretty dry up here, but it's much warmer, and the precipitable water is 44.9. So when you cool air, you squeeze out the moisture. This animation from NASA shows the water vapor in the atmosphere. The tropics are full of moisture, so storms are powerful, and gust fronts often trigger new storms. Coriolis force, which is needed to maintain the high and low pressure systems in the mid-latitudes, is weak in the tropics. Both of these factors make forecasting weather in the tropics difficult. It's a bit like paragliding weather, light winds with local influences playing a larger role in the weather. Subtle interactions of sea breezes, topography, and disturbances like the Gulf lines that drift across northern Australia. So you can see some activity across the Gulf of Carpentaria there, and some ahead here from the previous Gulf line. I watched the storms drift off with the trade winds one night in Bali, camped on Agung. They tend to happen over land in the afternoons and continue over the warm oceans during the night. A good strategy for tropical weather forecasting is persistence, looking at what happened yesterday. If there's lots of storm activity, the latent heat is released high in the atmosphere while rain cools the air on the way down, and this stabilizes the atmosphere. In the 2017 X-Alps, I made the mistake of trying to fly in thermals after storms. It was stable until it rained again.
Keep going.
Am I famous?
It takes nearly as much energy to melt ice as it does to bring it to the boil, and then over five times that for it to evaporate. In reality, some liquid is carried away in the steam. So evaporation has a huge cooling effect. That's why we sweat, and that helps cool us down a lot when the air is nice and dry. Gust fronts fan out from storms as rain pushes the air down. If there's any dry air, rain will evaporate, which further cools the air and adds strength to the downward gusts. I was surprised at the strength of this gust front channeling down a valley in Canada, near Golden. Not the best time to land, I reached over 100 k's ground speed on bar. Gust fronts are heavy cold air and are strongest near the ground, where I did a reverse park. If a storm is pushed along by upper winds, it can keep up with this gust front, and you can have a longer lived storm, sometimes forming a squall line like this one in Darwin. In the tropics, where there's not much else happening to disturb it, these can travel for a day or more. If there is too much power in the storm, the gust front outruns it, and if there's too much upper wind, the storm is torn apart. Remember though that a storm is massive and it can block the wind. My mate waited on Kinabalu for a week to fly off it. It was blown out in the trades until an approaching storm gave him a brief shelter from the wind. To think like a meteorologist, weather is heat redistribution. Wind is the main agent transporting heat horizontally, helped by ocean currents and precipitation evaporation imbalances like sea ice melting somewhere warmer. Thermals move heat from the ground up to cloud base. Latent heat helps transport heat vertically into the upper atmosphere. One of the main things we're concerned about in paragliding is the stability of the air mass. In a thermal, air cools at 10 degrees Celsius for every kilometre increase in altitude, so we need air of a similar lapse rate for the thermal to keep rising. But the average, or International Standard Atmosphere lapse rate, is 6.5 degrees per kilometre, and this is the same as the lapse rate inside a cumulus cloud. The difference to the 10 degrees is due to the latent heat releasing inside the cloud. So in general, the 6.5 degree lapse rate applies to anything above cloud base, and 10 degrees Celsius for anything below it. In Conungra, we get the best conditions in a southeasterly, as the cool, fresh air passes over warm oceans to be heated from below. When there are cumulus clouds, the evaporation at the top of the cloud cools the air above. This leads to a sink cycle, but the end result is air cooled from above, as well as heated from below. Good convection. If there is some depth to the clouds, they'll also offer some decent cloud suck to boost thermals and organise the air mass. Notice the clouds tend to get bigger, more consolidated and longer lasting as the day progresses, and thermals feeding them do the same. If they overdevelop, we get showers, which is fine if it's light and short-lived, but can douse the surface heat and shut down the area. With an increase in global temperature, exponentially more water vapour will provide fuel for severe weather. A hot, dry upper atmosphere will increase the frequency, severity, and length of heat waves. In most areas where people live, there will be less rainfall, but when it does rain, there will be more water and energy in the sky. In the next video, I'll look at some of the places I've flown in and talk about some climate change trends we can expect to see continue.